Good afternoon to everybody and good morning to my fellow presenters from the USA and Canada. My name is Professor Gregory Bogdanis and I'm chairing this invited symposium entitled Physiological and Psychological Impact of High Intensity Interval Training on Health and Well-being. I have with me two eminent scientists from the USA and from Canada. Todd Astorino is a professor at the California State University San Marcos Department of Kinesiology, and he will talk to us about lipid oxidation in response to high intensity interval training. And also from Canada, from the University of British Columbia, I have Associate Professor Mary Jung, who is going to talk to us about the psychological perspective of high intensity exercise. So I will go straight to my talk and I will speak to you about the physiological and metabolic responses to high intensity interval training, and especially about the influence of bout duration. This may be Greek to you, the first line, but it's from a physician about 18 centuries ago named Galen, who says that it doesn't seem that all movements are exercise, but only we can call exercise the movement that is vigorous. And vigorous exercise for him meant that there is a change in respiration. He also wrote in this book that the exercise should cease as soon as the body begins to suffer. And the suffering is something very familiar, in inverted commas, when somebody does high intensity exercise, especially when this exercise is at a very, very high intensity and at a relatively high volume. And he also said that exercise will be such that all the body parts move in proportion and not being worked either too hard or not hard enough. So 18 centuries ago, this physician talked about high intensity exercise. We know that several athletes have used high intensity training to improve their performances, like Paavo Nurmi in 1920 and Emil Zátopek. But recently, in the last 20 or so years, high intensity interval training has been used in the general public and also in patient groups. And high intensity exercise may be seen in many forms, like high intensity interval training, many names, high intensity functional training, when we use resistance exercise and other forms of exercise at high intensity in a circular fashion. There are many other forms, like high intensity circuit neuromuscular training, when exercisers do one set and then move to the next, and all these are performed at high intensity, or Tabata workouts. So this is the outline of my talk. I will first talk about terminology, what is high intensity interval exercise, just to introduce you to this concept. Then I will speak about the physiological and metabolic responses. Then I will touch upon the psychological responses, because Professor Jung will speak to you about that in detail. And then I will speak to you about the bout duration and the effect of bout duration on the physiological and psychological responses. And the question I will ask at the end is, can we manipulate physiological and metabolic and psychological responses to high intensity exercise just by altering bout duration? So in terms of terminology, we can divide high intensity exercise or interval, high intensity interval exercise into what we call sprint interval training, where the intensity is very high. It is as high as 50 or 60% above VO2 max. The duration, of course, is very short because the person is sprinting, and the rest is 1 to 6, up to 1.9. And of course, you cannot do so many repetitions of that. The type of high intensity training or exercise that we will deal in this session is what we call high intensity aerobic interval training. And here the intensity is lower. It may be as low as close to the lactate or ventilatory threshold, but it's usually between 85% and 100% of VO2 max. The duration of the bouts is 1 to 4 minutes, and the rest is usually 1 to 1. We can see visually two main forms of high intensity interval training. On the top panel, you can see one very common format that is 4 times 4 minutes at about 85 to 95% of heart rate peak, separated by 3 minute intervals of low intensity work, usually 50% of the high intensity work. And another form, another common form, is 10 times 1 minute, and the intensities here are between 85 and 100%. We can name these two kinds of protocols like as long interval exercise, the longer 4 minute intervals, and short high intensity interval exercise. And one way to define that is if you accumulate more than 15 minutes of time spent at high intensity, then you can call it long. If it's lower than that, you can call it short. And the effectiveness of this type of training depends on the magnitude of the physiological, metabolic, and hormonal responses. So if we have a look at some physiological responses like the heart rate, here we see three types of protocols. Let me use this pointer here. This is 30 seconds work, 30 seconds rest, and these are the intensities close to VO2 max is the intensity of work. 3 minutes work and 3 minutes rest, or continuous exercise at 83%. So one criterion that this exercise is actually pushing your body to adapt is the time spent above a certain high percentage of VO2 peak. For example, we can see here that the time spent above 90% of VO2 peak is almost double when the intervals are long, when you do 3 minutes on, 3 minutes off. Of course, there are other formats that we will see later that the short interval exercise is better in that respect. Now, if we go to the metabolic responses, the metabolic responses refer mainly to changes that we see or adaptations that we see at the level of the mitochondria. So if there is a disturbance of the homeostasis, if we have accumulation of metabolites like lactate, hydrogen ions, phosphate in the muscle, these actually start a cascade, and there is a production of PGC1-alpha, which is the master regulator of mitochondria synthesis. So if the exercise is intense enough to cause these metabolic perturbations, we have adaptations at the mitochondria. We can see on this slide here that the metabolic stress is very important to cause changes in PGC1 alpha, where a protocol of speed endurance exercise, which is 6 times 20 seconds all-out cycling, caused a higher production of muscle lactate and a higher increase in PGC1 alpha compared with shorter interval exercise. So we have seen so far that the intensity is very important to achieve these adaptations. If we compare the longer protocols and the shorter protocols in terms of lactate responses, something that we can measure very easily in the blood, we see that these two types of protocols are almost equal in terms of lactate concentration in the blood. So they are both severe or heavy exercise. This heavy exercise and these metabolic perturbations have been thought to cause or are causing actually physiological, psychological responses. And some researchers have proposed that the harder the exercise or the greater the disturbance of the homeostasis, the greater the psychological responses. So here we see a decrease in the feeling scale, pleasure and displeasure, when you do hard exercise. And these authors have proposed that this is proportional to the oxygen uptake. More about that will be analyzed about from Professor Jung. So in this very early study, 1960, by Ostrad and colleagues, with an N of one, there is one individual here. They have actually broken down the continuous heavy exercise into smaller parts of half a minute on, half a minute off. And what they've seen is that if you break down the exercise, if you divide it into half a minute on, half a minute off, it is much easier to do this exercise for 1 hour, and the concentration of blood lactate is almost the same as if you do low intensity continuous exercise. Many decades later, Davis and colleagues have done a similar kind of experiment, but this was done in a magnet, and they could measure phosphocreatine and pH changes. So here they examined bouts of 16 seconds on, 32 seconds off, or 32 on, 64 off, and so on, at an intensity close to the peak aerobic power. And they have seen that the longer the bout duration, the greater the contribution of anaerobic metabolism, and the lower the pH. And this is for exactly the same work, but broken down in smaller bouts. On the left here, you can see the contribution of glycolysis, oxidative metabolism, and phosphocreatine when the bout is short, when it's 16 seconds. You can see that there is almost no contribution of glycolysis. Whereas if the bout is longer, if it's 64 seconds, the contribution of glycolysis is considerable. So by just changing the bout duration, you can change the contribution of glycolysis and phosphocreatine. And the effect of bout duration is so much that if you, for example, in this experiment here, increase the bout duration from 30 seconds to 40 seconds, there is an amazing decrease in exercise tolerance. Of course, here the interval is changed as well. The interval is shortened, but the effect of bar duration is huge. You can do only 1/4 of the exercise compared to the slightly shorter part. This concept of breaking down the exercise into smaller or shorter bouts is known to the patient population. Here you can see some patients that have chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And if you do continuous exercise at 80% of work max, the actual time to exhaustion is about 10 minutes. But if you break it down to 30 seconds at 100% of work max, and followed by 30 seconds of rest, you can do 32 minutes of exercise. We also know that the shorter the bar duration, the lower the RPE, the rating of perceived exertion. So you feel less, you feel that exercise is less hard if the bout is shorter. So of all these variables that affect the physiological and metabolic stress during high intensity exercise, let's see now the effect of bout duration by making all the other variables standardized. So in this experiment that is in preparation, we have done continuous exercise at an intensity of about 50% of peak power output. And then we broken down the same total work into 10 seconds work, 15 seconds rest, and we have done the same amount of work in the same time using the same ratio of work to rest, 1 to 1.5. So total work is the same. And we compared it also to 30 seconds of exercise followed by 45 seconds of low intensity exercise. And here again, the total work is the same. And also we compared it with 60 seconds of work and 90 seconds of rest. And again, in all these conditions, the total work is the same, the total exercise time is the same, the total resting or recovery time is the same. If you look and compare the average intensity in terms of percentage of VO2 peak attained, we can see that in the three protocols of high intensity interval exercise, and I have to stress that all the variables are the same. The intensity of exercise is the same. It's 100% of VO2 max. We see that it is the same average intensity or energy expenditure in terms of VO2. You can see it here when the measurements are broken down in 2.5 minute intervals. Again, you see that there is no difference between the average oxygen uptake, and there is no difference in the average heart rate. But if you look at these responses every 5 or 10 seconds, what you see is that when you do the shorter interval, and please follow the line here, there is no fluctuation of VO2. If you do 30 second bound, there is a smaller, but there is a fluctuation of VO2. And if you do the longer bout, the VO2 fluctuates a lot. Of course, the average VO2 is the same, but you can see there's a huge difference in these fluctuations. And the same you can see here with heart rate. So the longer the bout duration, the higher the fluctuation of heart rate. If you see the shorter bout here, the fluctuation is almost non-existent. Let's take a look at another two variables here. You can see the ventilation, and I'm taking again the 10 seconds on, 15 seconds off. There is almost no fluctuation. And the 60 seconds on, 90 seconds off, there's a huge fluctuation. Look at the value here of the ventilation at the last bout. So we're talking about two different physiological responses for the same exercise. And here is the same with the respiratory exchange ratio. Again, here is the longer bouts. So you can see that the 10 second bouts on, 15 seconds off, are actually the same as doing continuous exercise. We can see these differences in the lactate, blood lactate responses. Again, please follow these squares here when you do 10 seconds on, 15 seconds off. And look at the difference with the 60 seconds on, 90 seconds off. 12 millimoles here and almost 6 millimoles here. As we said before, these metabolic perturbations have an effect on the perceptual responses. So you feel that the exercise is harder when we do the longer interval. But in this experiment, we had the same RPE for the continuous exercise and the 10 second bouts. And also here, the pleasure displeasure, the feeling scale, it was the same in continuous exercise and 10 second bouts, but it was different when the bout was longer. So the conclusions from this work was that the physiological and metabolic responses vary widely during different bout durations, and the bout durations are less than 30 seconds seem to disturb homeostasis much less. And these large differences occur without reducing the intensity, so it's high intensity exercise, or the work to rest ratio, or the total exercise volume. Of course, I mentioned that the neuromuscular load is the same because people are cycling at the same cadence. The only thing that is changed is the load. So high intensity formats may be chosen depending on the target of training. Just to very quickly show you a result of a recent experiment where we compared the 10 second bouts with the 60 second bouts when we did an 8-week training in inactive obese males. What we've seen is that both protocols have caused a decrease in total fat mass and an increase in lean body mass in these obese individuals. And they also caused a very large increase in fat oxidation. So they are both effective. So a bout that you can do with much less effort, if you like, and much less displeasure has the same effects on body composition. Just one general consideration about high intensity exercise, because we have shown now that the bout duration is very important. We need to do more research to see if the training status has a role here, because if somebody is trained, he's going to perceive the same exercise differently than an untrained person. And also the same person doing again and again the bouts of exercise, as training progresses, things are different, both in metabolic and probably psychological ways. So in conclusion, we have seen that bout duration affects the physiological, metabolic, and the psychological responses to high intensity training. Shorter durations may be used as a gateway to more intense high intensity training because they look like they are easier and they are disturbing metabolism less while doing the same work by choosing a short bout. This high intensity exercise may be transformed to very enjoyable and highly tolerable exercise just by manipulating the bout duration. And finally, research has to be done to show what the effect of fitness level and training status is on these metabolic, physiological, and psychological responses. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm going to see if there are any questions. Okay, we have no questions, so I will proceed to the next speaker, Professor Astorino, who is going to talk to us about fat oxidation and high intensity exercise. The floor is yours. Well, the scene is yours.
Thank you very much. All right, everyone. Well, good morning from California, and thank you for attending this session today. Before I begin my talk, I want to thank some people who have been extremely important in my career. First, I want to thank Dr. Marty Gabala. Going back almost a decade ago, I wanted to test the effects of Wingate style training in less fit adults, and I was a little bit hesitant as I did not know if they could actually do it. And at the time, I reached out to Marty and he assured me that they could, and this served as almost a springboard for my work in this area. Second, I want to thank the ECSS for, in fact, allowing us to speak this morning. Third, I want to thank my co-conspirators, Mary and Greg, and especially Greg, for actually setting up this session. And lastly, very, very little of my work could have been done without the effort as well as dedication of a large group of students, mostly at the undergraduate level over my career. So my talk's going to cover these six main points. First, I'm going to review the epidemic of obesity. And then I'm going to make a case for why it is a fat oxidation may actually matter. I'm going to share with you some data which concern the effects of fat oxidation, sorry, the changes in fat oxidation in response to more intense exercise, such as HIIT. I'm going to address various methodological issues. I'm going to share with you some data that are unpublished, and last, I'm going to raise some areas that still remain to be explored. And so, that being said, here are data from the CDC, and these are from the last 20 years. And what we see that there has been an increasing incidence of adults with obesity in the U.S. and this is classified as a BMI above a score of 30. So going back about 20 years, roughly one third of adults were obese. Yet in the last couple years, this has increased to more than 40% of adults. What's even more alarming is the amount of adults that have a BMI above a value of 35, as this trend has actually doubled in this 20-year period, to now about 9% of adults have severe obesity. So we are all well aware of the complications, the consequences of this excess body weight. Increased risk and incidence of high blood pressure, dyslipidemia, some forms of cancers, as well as increasing risk of stroke and diabetes. And all of this served to reduce the quality of life of that patient. So, how does fat oxidation fit in this area? Well, if you go back 30 or 40 years to some of the seminal studies which showed an increase in fat oxidation in response to exercise, much of that work was equated to a sparing of glycogen and thus an increase in sports performance. Yet, more current work tends to suggest that this may actually be linked to increased health. Here's some work from Zurich, Lowe and colleagues, where they showed that subjects, in this case, a group of Pima Indians, those that had a higher 24-hour RQ, that means a higher use of carbohydrate at rest, were about 2.5 times a greater risk of fairly large weight gain compared to those who were more apt to burn more fat at rest. Moving ahead about 25 years, we can look at the results of Robinson and colleagues, who in a group of young men showed a positive association between the maximal rate of fat oxidation and insulin sensitivity. And so now I think it is pretty well known that one's ability to burn or oxidize fat is associated with our metabolic health. So Greg did a wonderful job actually explaining various forms of HIIT, but I just want to add to this a little bit. So we have at least 3 widely used protocols of HIIT. We have the 4x4, which involves a large amount of work, and this has been used with great success in cardiac patients, especially in Norway. If we want to reduce the volume and amp up the intensity markedly, we can use a classic Wingate-based protocol where we have 4 to 6 all up 30-second sprints. And in the last about 10 years, scientists in the UK, they've acknowledged that this Wingate-based protocol is extremely, the word I'll use is unpleasant. And though, so they have chosen to reduce the number of sprints from 4 to 6 to 2, to reduce the length of the sprints from 30 seconds to actually 20 seconds, and to reduce the number of sprints from 4 to 6 to only 2. And this is done in a session that only lasts for 10 minutes. Their work has shown an increase in VO2 max, as well as other health-based markers, you know, in sedentary adults, as well as those with type 2 diabetes. So it may be kind of surprising that intense exercise such as HIIT, which has this rapid rate of glycogen breakdown and in turn a large amount of lactate accumulation, how can this enhance the ability to burn fat? Well, you can look at some very, very elegant work from Kent Saulin's lab that may help to explain this. In this study in unfit adults, they performed 2 bouts of exercise, which actually lasted 1.5 hours. One of the bouts was moderate exercise at 67% of VO2 max, whereas the other bout had a totally different structure. Sprints at a super maximal intensity. And across these bouts, not only was the time matched, also there was no difference in heart rate, RPE, or lactate concentration. The subjects, in fact, underwent a biopsy of the vastus lateralis before as well as 3 hours after exercise. And here are just a little bit of the data that I want to share with you. So on the y-axis here, we have the mRNA expression, and this is a fold change compared to pre-exercise. And this here represents the moderate intensity bout. This is the bout of SIT, the sprints, if you will. And the main finding here is that both modes of exercise induce about a 10 to 12 fold expression of PGC1 alpha, which as Greg had said, seems to be the regulator of the growth of mitochondria. And this result and other work led these authors to conclude that SIT, as well as moderate exercise, they influence the transcription of genes involved in aerobic metabolism to the same extent. So that being said, if you're going to measure the change in fat oxidation during any kind of exercise training protocol or regimen, what are some things that need to be considered? Well, first, it's well known that there's a large amount of variability in either fat oxidation or perhaps maximal fat oxidation across days. And this can range from as low as about 20% to as high as 30%, even though the mean scores across those two days are very similar. Next, there's work that shows that only a one-day change in diet modifies fat oxidation. Last but not least, recent work shows that physical activity is in fact associated with the rate of maximal fat oxidation. And so these are factors that need to not only be accounted for, but perhaps considered in these studies to try and reduce the error in our data. Okay, and so I now want to turn to how does more intense exercise such as HIIT modify fat oxidation? And this is work from Larry Spreet's lab in Canada. And in the study, unfit women took part in 7 days of high volume HIIT on the bike. And this was performed over only a 2 week time period. And here are some of the data. So this comes from a 1 hour bout of cycling of moderate intensity, which was performed at baseline and then after training. The squares represent the values prior to training. In the triangles here, these are the values post. And what we see is that 30, 45, and 60 minutes into this exercise bout, training led to an increase in the rate of fat oxidation. This in turn was matched by a decline in the rate of carbohydrate oxidation. So what may be some of the mechanisms or perhaps the reasons which explain these results? Well, two of them are shown here. We have on the y-axis, okay, the maximal enzyme activity, and we have on the x-axis beta HAD as well as citrate synthase. The white bar is prior to training, the black bar is post. And what we see in the trained state, women revealed an increasing beta HAD activity as well as citrate synthase. In addition, training led to an increase in the protein content of fatty acid binding protein, yet there was no change in either hormone sensitive lipase or fat CD36. This work suggests that there is an increasing function of mitochondria, or perhaps an increasing oxidative capacity that may lead to this enhanced fat oxidation. Okay, so if you look at a lot of the data in this area, unfortunately, it's obtained from young and healthy adults and or those who are not obese. Yet, it is possible that being able to burn or oxidize more fat may be more important to health in obese adults. And so here's some recent work from some scientists in Italy who compared the effects of 3 months of HIIT on the treadmill compared to moderate exercise. At the end of training, they actually followed up with these adults for 4 months. And here's a little bit of the data. And so we have here on the y-axis the change in fat oxidation. We have on the x-axis VO2 peak expressed as a percent. and this was obtained from a graded exercise test. Okay, the baseline data are shown here in green. The red reflects the data obtained with 3 months of training. And what we see is that training in this group of obese adults led to an increasing rate of fat oxidation at 60 and 70% of VO2 peak compared to baseline. 4 months later, fat oxidation was still actually elevated compared to baseline. Yet the group that engaged in moderate exercise did not reveal any change in fat oxidation. Furthermore, with a biopsy, results showed an increasing ADP stimulated mitochondrial respiration, as well as a maximal electron transport system capacity in response to both forms of exercise. And this led these authors to conclude that HIIT may increase the oxidative phosphorylation capacity rather than the efficiency of this system. So I now want to share with you some relatively new data from our lab. And these were obtained in a group of young sedentary women who were non-obese. And they engaged in 9 days of HIIT on the bike at a workload of 85% of PPO. And what we did in the study is we performed the graded exercise test at baseline twice to try and get a better understanding of the change in fat oxidation. And we used these data to compute a minimum difference score. We also assessed physical activity for 2 days prior to each of these bouts with an accelerometer. And we had these women do a 2-day diet recall before the first bout, and we asked them to replicate this before the second bout. And these are the data. So here is the rate of fat oxidation on the y-axis, and these are the 5 intensities that were used during our GXT. Results showed an increase in the rate of fat oxidation at 10, 20, and 30% of PPO in response to training. And this was in fact associated with about an 8 to 10% increase in VO2 max. In turn, there was a decline in the rate of carbohydrate oxidation at intensities which range from 10 to 40% of PPO. Yet, these data that stem from our repeated measures NOVA don't tell the true story of the change in fat oxidation. Because when we use the minimum difference score, which was equal to 0.08 grams per minute, we see that only 5 of our 22 women in fact revealed a meaningful change in fat oxidation. We have some who in the post-training test, actually their fat oxidation decreased. And then we have others here that showed basically no change. So the last bit of data that I'm going to share with you today comes from a recent collaboration that I have had with Dr. Muhammed Atakan, who is based in Turkey. And we have in fact created a systematic review, meta-analysis, which has examined the effects of HIIT compared to aerobic exercise or a non-exercise control group on the change in fat oxidation. We have a total of 17 studies with an N of close to 500 adults. Length of studies range from 2 to 14 weeks. And here are some of our data. So when you compare the change in fat oxidation with HIIT versus a control condition, we see an effect here of 0.08 grams per minute. Yet we see that this does actually vary across these eight studies. When we compare studies which employed both HITs as well as MICT, we see a small effect of HIT. And in fact, HIT was viewed as more effective than moderate exercise to increase the rate of fat oxidation. When we perform sub-analyses on our data, two trends arose, and these are shown here. It seems like protocols of HIT that involve a larger amount of training in terms of weeks, as well as a larger dose. So this is the actual time spent engaged in HIT may increase the rate of fat oxidation compared to regimens or protocols that are shorter and involved a smaller amount of training. So these are some things that may be of interest in the future. There's still very, very little data which show any of the mechanisms which may explain an increase in fat oxidation seen in obese adults who engage in HIIT or SIIT. Secondly, if you look at these studies, some use a graded exercise test to examine the change in fat oxidation, whereas others use a single load or intensity of exercise. Does this matter? Third, is it better or preferred to have all the subjects eat a standardized meal or meals in the day before the exercise test, or do you want them to follow their ad lib diet? And last, I hope I have showed you that it is extremely important to strictly account for and to consider all the factors which may actually modify the measurement of fat oxidation. So to conclude, it seems that high intensity interval training will induce an increase in fat oxidation compared to no exercise. Also, it is possible that a larger dose of HIIT may be in fact needed to augment this increase in fat oxidation. Thirdly, just like the change in VO2 max, some adults do not show an increase in fat oxidation with HIIT. And is this a physiological effect, or is it more based on the methods that we employ? And last but not least, it may be important to perform more than one graded exercise test at baseline. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Todd, for this thorough presentation. Very clear. We have no questions on the panel, so I will ask a question to you. I think it's a practical question. How much fat can a person burn during a HIIT session? And does this fat burning translate to loss of fat, in the long term?
Yeah. Greg, as you know, and we all know, if you look in the lay science, right, there is this almost myth that HIIT is just, this wonderful approach to burn all this fat and lose all this fat. And of course, the data are not quite that strong. As you had shown and others, if you compare the change in body weight, and body fat between, HIIT or SIIT compared to aerobic exercise, typically there's not much of a difference in these outcomes right across the regimens. Similarly, if you do something like an EPOC study, where you look at the change in fat oxidation, the change in VO2, as well as calorie expenditure after these bouts, that work is very mixed or equivocal. So I do not think that HIIT should be sold as a means to burn fat or to change your body weight or body fat dramatically. I think it needs to be sold as, here's a time efficient, mostly, form of exercise that can augment the increase in fitness. That being said, I don't think it is clear that burning fat during these bouts, or perhaps the magnitude of that change, is linked to fat loss. I don't think we can say that yet.
Thank you. This is the reason why I asked this question, because people are thinking, and there is a wide spread idea on the internet that you can lose a lot of fat by doing high intensity exercise. So we see people in the gym, and sometimes they are obese and they're running on a treadmill as fast as they can.
Right.
And this is very detrimental for their knees, for example, because they are heavy and they do
right.
this type of exercise. And may I take this chance to stress that for obese people and very heavy people, I would propose to them to do non-weight bearing exercise to start with, because the load on the joints is too high if they try to run.
Right.
So it's better if they do cycling or elliptical machine. And we know that muscle damage or inflammation is not so high, or is very low, when you do cycling, which is purely concentric exercise, compared to running, which is a stress shortening cycle.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Todd.
Of course.
Well, I can I ask another question then? I don't know if Mary wants to ask a question, but I will ask another question. What do you think is the best regimen of high intensity exercise to burn fat?
Yeah, so I can look at our own data, and it is hard to come up with that answer, just because the studies where we have measured fat oxidation have been so different. So, you know, for the first one that we did was 6 days of Wingate style training, and that was done in active adults. We actually followed that up with 12 weeks of HIIT in sedentary women. And then we did a 6 week intervention that was done in active adults. So the first two studies showed an increase in fat oxidation, whereas the last one did not, even though the last one had a total of close to 40 subjects. And so I would probably say, if you want to plan a study that's going to lead to an increase in fat oxidation, you want to use adults in the low end of fitness, and you'd probably want to use higher volume training. Now, of course, that may be problematic in the sense that tends to increase RPE, you know, reduce effects. And so then it becomes a little bit less pleasant, tolerated, if you will. But yeah, if that was my main goal, that's probably what I would do.
Okay, thank you very much, Todd. So I will move on with our last speaker, Professor Mary Jung, who will speak to us about the psychological effects of high-intensity training. And she has chosen a very nice and provocative title. Is HIIT hated or not? So Mary, the stage is yours.
All right, great, thank you. Just gonna pull up my slides here, interview. There we go. So please let me know if this is okay here. Well, I'll echo Todd's thanks at the beginning, just thanks to was attending live today, and also to Greg and Todd for allowing me to present with them. I'm very excited. I love bringing up the rear, talking about some of the other components of why we should or shouldn't do HIIT. So I'll just dive right in. Being the third presenter out of three, I recognize attention span may be low, so I'm going to go right to the take-home points. So if you nod off during my presentation, you will have already known what I want you to cover, and that is that HIIT, high-intensity interval training, is feasible. It's something that people like to do, and that people can actually stick to it, or people can actually adhere to it. And I've got some exciting data that I'd love to share with you about that. And so, you know, from people often ask from a psychological perspective, why did you ever get involved in this? And that was back in the time where not many psychologists were looking at it. And I can tell you really briefly that I think this meta-analysis has already been referenced by Greg, but the idea that physiologists were studying why this is such a potent tool for so many years. So it was very popular in a kinesiology field for HIIT to be studied, but it was also very popular in the general public. And so this is back in 2018, but in 2021, HIIT still remains one of the top three trends in North America. So, you know, I suppose health and fitness fanatics were very obsessed with HIIT. And then, of course, the general public has been very obsessed with HIIT. We know by the sheer number of infographics, such as this one, that it's out there. People want to know why people should do it, what it is all about, and how to do it. So it's hot in a lot of domains, not so hot in some of the academic circles that I sit in. And so this paper came out in 2014. It was an opinion, and it was great because it stimulated a lot of thought and debates, actually debates at conferences international, as well as a lot of commentary coming back to this article, because there was not a strong or unanimous belief in what the article was suggesting. And so really briefly, HIIT not so hot in this year from this group of scientists, because they stated that it might evoke sensations of low self-esteem, incompetence, even failure. It might result in negative affect and low enjoyment, which could lead to avoiding exercise in the future altogether, could require high level of self-discipline and self-regulation, and is actually not time efficient, they said. So that's a lot to debunk and discuss. I'm going to focus in on the affective response to HIIT, the perceptions, pleasure, displeasure, and cognitive belief in pleasant enjoyment intentions, and whether it actually does lead to avoidance of exercise in the future. And I'm going to do that by going through some of the data. There's so much data out there now, it's actually difficult to go through it all in a short period of time. So I'm trying to give shout outs with the slides and the pieces that I pulled, but apologies if I've missed some of the articles if you are present here today. So first and foremost, HIIT is feasible. It's not just for athletes. Sorry, I apologize.
Can't do much better right now.
Sorry, dog walking by. That's awesome, thanks. Okay, sorry about that. These are people from my lab, some who have done studies all based in HIIT. On exercise equipment, but also outdoors. And I just wanted to show you this because I think we have these pictures of young, healthy undergraduate students doing HIIT. I never do that. It's always with individuals living with a chronic disease and absolutely can do HIIT. Another picture people are probably more familiar with is an accelerometer. So this is when I tell people how to do HIIT, and then they go off in the real world and do it themselves. And you can see, of course, you're familiar with the light, moderate, and vigorous yellow horizontal lines. And you can see very cleanly that when they're out in the real world, they definitely get into vigorous intensity during the HIIT intervals, and then get back down during their rest. Interestingly, that rest recovery piece always takes place in the moderate zone, so they don't often get to light intensity. When we look at individuals doing HIIT who have type 2 diabetes, yellow bars are just simply showing you they absolutely are achieving the workload for, this is a 10x1 protocol. But what I want to draw your attention to is the RPE. So their perceived exertion level for the whole body starts out just at 5 out of 10 and only gets up to 8 out of 10. So despite having the same workload throughout all 10 intervals, they don't think that they're working that hard. And so this type of data mimics what Gregory already demonstrated with some of his lab data. This is in a group of overweight and obese individuals, otherwise healthy. And I'm just going to quickly orient you. I used to use the terminology, I won't anymore because I know it's confusing, but continuous vigorous intensity, or CVI. That'd be like going out and doing a 40-minute vigorous intensity bout. Continuous moderate intensity, the black line, CMI, is when we were asking them to do it, but that length, but more moderately, and then HIIT in blue. So anyways, you can see here really plainly that they're working as hard as the continuous vigorous intensity. This was a randomized crossover design. So these individuals worked as hard as when they engaged in the CVI bout. But when you actually decipher what happens during the recovery periods of intervals, you see that their RPE goes right back down, similar to CMI levels or continuous moderate intensity levels. So we can start to understand that when we play with the components of an interval workout, that it really does influence how one is thinking. And that might be important. Lots of systematic and meta-analyses have demonstrated the feasibility and acceptability of engaging in HIIT in a variety of populations that are dealing with health complications and multiple comorbidities. So I think we can tick that off quite easily, and I could have rhymed off a dozen systematic and meta-analyses here. So moving on to the second point is that people can actually enjoy engaging in HIIT. So affect has gotten a lot of attention, again, as Gregory nicely introduced already. This is kind of can be broken down. Affect, when we commonly see it in papers surrounding HIIT, is thinking about the immediate gut reaction response. So, you know, putting your hand on the hot burner, pulling it off right away, you know, it's pleasant or unpleasant. I want to move away from it, or I want to come closer to it. And that is thought to be an influencer on one's decision, which takes cognitive appraisal to engage in exercise of any kind. So I want to acknowledge here, and I'll end off on the same take home point, that there's a heck of a lot more factors other than affect going on when we decide to exercise or not. But as it was, there is a lot of data on affect and responses to HIIT, so I'll cover it, including some data from my lab. So really briefly, the dashed HIIT line is the one in the middle here on this graph. And we see, and we're just looking at crude feeling scale affect, gut response reaction in the moment to whatever exercise bout they're engaging in, we see that affective response is less positive than continuous moderate intensity activity. So a bike ride, 50% to 65%, and it's less averse than continuous vigorous intensity activity. So going again continuously at a higher intensity. Not a big surprise. It's what we're anticipating finding. When we do this again in individuals with obesity, we see again, not surprisingly, HIIT's going to have lower affective response than water intensity continuous activity. But it is interesting to note that it's above the 0 point. So it's not negative, but it's lower for sure. Now, what happens when we start manipulating these components? So this is work I did with Dr. Gerd at Queen's University in Ontario, Canada, and we manipulated the interval intensity. So everyone was doing intermittent interval exercise, but they were doing it at 65% intensity, 90%, 120%. As you can see from the circles and complete filled in circles here, the more intense your intervals were, the lower your affective response became. And you can see it goes below zero. So it's becoming negative affect. So in other words, you might say this is displeasurable. So 0 to 5 is pleasurable, 0 to -5 is displeasurable. When we manipulate interval times, this is work I did with Marcus Kilpatrick at Florida in United States. We can see an interesting effect happening here as well. So here you see continuous vigorous intensity exercises, the red. The turquoise is HIIT for 30 second intervals. The blue is 60 second intervals, and the purple dashed is HIIT engaging 2 minutes at a time, so 120 second intervals. So the longer your intervals are, the lower your affective scores. Again, in this study, we did not find that it went below zero. So this is similar to some of the data that Gregory already showed. I know this is a lot, but I wanted to show it all at once. I just published this PhD student in my lab, and what I'm showing here is that your experience with intervals can influence how we respond to exercise, respond to HIIT. So all graphs are showing MICT as moderate intensity continuous training as the solid black and HIIT as the dashed black. And I want you to just look at the general trends. So the time points are day 1 of training, day 6 of training, and day 10 of training. And we did this across 2 weeks. So 5 days of training, Monday to Friday, across 2 weeks. And just basically seeing that general trend at the very bottom one in the center is intention to exercise. Both groups start out okay with exercise. By the end of 10 days of doing it, either protocol, they're intending to do much more of it. When we look at our instrumental and affective attitudes, which is the middle two graphs, again, you're just seeing there's no difference between the groups. They're both going up. And then at the top ones, we have your peak negative in-task affect and your post-exercise enjoyment. You can see your peak negative in-task affect for both conditions is going down slightly, as you would expect in an exercise protocol. You're not feeling as fresh and as awesome as you are at the beginning of the workout at the end. And then, and you're getting a bit, I would say, tired or possibly bored of either exercise protocol by the time you've done 10 intervals, or sorry, 10 sessions of it with us in the lab. And I'll come back to that point. And then the one on the right-hand side, exercise enjoyment, we see both are more, find exercise more enjoyable after they've done 10 sessions of it. So a lot of data coming on here. I just want to summarize by saying, I think that the in-task affective response to HIIT, it's generally more pleasurable than continuous vigorous. And so it's really inappropriate to lump HIIT into continuous modes of vigorous exercise. I think it is different. I think the data shows it's different. But I think that how different is it? I can't say it's always lower or it's always this or that, because I think it depends on how we build our interval protocols, specifically how intense are your interval bouts, how long are your interval bouts, and how much experience does your clientele, your patient, your participant have with HIIT? So like I said, there's lots of other factors that go into whether we decide to do HIIT. I'm going to show one more, but there's probably about 20 others that I could show that have possibly stronger beta weights in the predictive utility of exercise adherence. But here, nonetheless, affective attitudes, this is when we start thinking about after the workout has completed, did I actually enjoy this? Would I be willing to do this again? You know, if I had the choice of two or three different types of exercise, what would I choose? And so when we look at the original, or one of the original articles by Bartlett in the UK, was showing us that, hey, it's really interesting. We put healthy undergraduate males on a treadmill and we got them to do really something really hard. And even though it was much harder than their continuous moderate intensity, they still said that they enjoyed it more. So it got a lot of people thinking. Including myself. And so when we asked people, how much did you enjoy it? We didn't find a difference between how much they enjoyed HIIT and how much they enjoyed continuous moderate intensity, but we find that difference between continuous vigorous intensity and HIIT. We asked them again, if you had to do this three times a week in perpetuity, what would you enjoy most? And here we see the differences between HIIT and CVI again. So this is a work back at McMaster University where I did my undergrad and my master's with, and this is out of Marty Gabala's lab. It's already mentioned here. So we looked at, after individuals with type 2 diabetes had engaged in 2 weeks of HIIT, so they did 6 sessions there, what do they think that they will enjoy going forward? And you can see the line for continuous moderate intensity for 60 minutes. Someone, I know that difference there. They said, you know, would you enjoy doing that for 60 minutes? They said, after experiencing it, no way. What I would enjoy doing is HIIT or continuous moderate intensity for 30 minutes. So, and when we look at engaging in Tabata protocols with, of course, body weight, resistance using the traditional Tabata protocol. Again, we see that people find it challenging, but they actually enjoy it more after they've had some experience with it, which is nice to see. When we ask people, what would you prefer to do? We see, of course, it's not unanimous. I don't think anybody would ever expect it to be, but we do see a preference, higher preference for people engaging in HIIT workouts after we've given them a taste of continuous moderate intensity and continuous vigorous intensity isocalorically matched. This is some great work out of Todd Ostorino's lab and really strong findings just showing that, hey, they work harder. No question about it, no matter what measure we're looking at, people engaging in HIIT are working harder than when they engage in moderate intensity continuous training workouts. But despite that, 11 out of the 12 participants in this trial preferred to do HIIT. And despite having lower affective response in task, higher heart rate, higher AOPE, and blood lactate, they're still preferring or choosing HIIT. Todd, I'm sure can correct me if I'm wrong there. So this is kind of summarized in one of my postdoctoral fellows in my lab, Matthew Stork's scoping review in 2017, and it's a long quote, so I won't read it all, but I'll highlight the green. And just really, the scoping review says, if we look at all the data on the psychological responses to engaging in HIIT as compared to continuous modalities of exercise, enjoyment and preferences are about equal. And so from a psych perspective, it supports the viability, or we should keep it as an option, as not to replace continuous exercise, but as something that we might want to consider. And this was followed up again from Kilpatrick and Oliveira and their review a year later, just really stating that chronic studies should clarify the applicability of HIIT for adherence, but generally it seems just as good. And so I think that it does elicit less positive affect in task for sure, but they still tend to enjoy it, possibly even more, and they still prefer it as compared to moderate intensity continuous exercise. So I'll wrap up with a discussion on adherence. And there's actually surprisingly very little studies done on at long-term free living exercise adherence to HIIT. And so I apologize, this is all coming from my lab, but I can't find a comparison otherwise. So really, we first started out looking at a pilot. So this is acknowledge a very small N, 32 participants we randomized to hit or MIPT. But we found some data that was exciting enough preliminarily to provoke a more robust trial. So really briefly, we found that we train people to do HIT, we kick them out of the lab, same thing with MIC, out of the lab on their own. 1 month later, they come back, their accelerometer shows us that they engage in more minutes of vigorous and moderate intensity exercise. So we followed it up with a 6 month follow-up time point. Again, we saw supportive evidence that HIT may be a viable option. So you can see here, participants prescribed HIT at 6 months are engaging in significantly more minutes of vigorous intensity exercise and moderate intensity exercise, not so much. Not surprising, we didn't prescribe them any. So the same design again, this time full-blown funded RCT in 100 individuals living with prediabetes, and we assessed the primary outcome of cardiorespiratory fitness at 6 and 12 months after they engage in 2 weeks of training. So as you can see, there's no significant difference between HIT and MICT in cardiorespiratory fitness, absolute, relative, or peak power output measures. And again, the cardiorespiratory fitness primary outcome variable, we're really thinking about because we prescribe so many different minutes of exercise, it may not be the best marker of adherence. We know that if people are exercising, they're likely getting fitter. But it's difficult to start measuring minutes when we're only prescribing half the number of minutes for HIT as compared to MICT. But we did look at the secondary accelerometry data from the trial, and actually it's exactly what it said. We found the increase in minutes higher in the MICT condition as compared to HIT. Again, not surprisingly, given that we prescribed them 150 minutes versus 75 minutes in HIT. But we did look at the prescribed, their adherence to the prescribed number of exercise minutes per week, and it was the same between each condition. So you can take it for what it's worth. I think the take home here is that people stick to HIT, or at least as good as they stick to any other type of exercise. Short on time, so I'll just quickly conclude by saying, all that talk about affect, you know, we published this paper and another one's about to come out, just really demonstrating that it might be, it is a very interesting psychological construct to examine. When we look at it from and does it relate with interval based exercise adherence, we actually find no relationship either at 1 month follow up or at 6 month follow up. It does not appear that in task affective response during a HIT bout actually predicts exercise adherence. And we found the same thing when we followed it up at 6 months, negative interaction. So my conclusions, affective response to HIT does differ from continuous forms. Affective response does not appear to predict intermittent exercise engagement. Interestingly, it's still preferred and enjoyable, even though it might be more challenging to complete. And then I just ask everyone to remember that HIT is prescribed based on relative intensity. So it's absolutely doable for everyone. It's at their intensity level. So thank you very much for your time, and I will end off on that.
Thank you very much, Mary. This was a clear presentation showing that HIT is feasible by almost anybody. Can I ask one question? It is not directly related to what you said, but since you are a director of the Diabetes Prevention Research Group and you are researching about the self-regulation of exercise and dietary habits, when people start an exercise program, either high intensity or lower continuous exercise, do they modify their diets differently if they do HIT or if they do continuous exercise or other forms of exercise? Have you any data on that?
No, that's a great question, actually. And similar to some of the research, we've looked at compensatory behavior, physical activity wise, to hit a post hit versus MIPT. And we found no such compensatory behavior, but we haven't done it in looking at diet. And maybe after Todd's answer to your question about what we need to be looking at from a diet perspective and how that influences fat oxidation after hit, I should look into that. But we prescribe a particular diet, but we don't prescribe it differently between groups.
I think there's a lot more to research on this topic. The topic of exercise and diet and high intensity exercise and diet is huge. So people definitely modify their diet when they start an exercise program. And this is probably a problem that we have as physiologists, because we want them to stick to the same diet, but people usually change both. They start exercising and they start a diet.
Yeah, no, you're right.
So there's a lot more to
do. I have a question, Greg, for Mary.
Great
talk, Mary. Thank you. What do you know about the effects of some like personality on these scores and outcomes?
Yeah, good question. We did look at the big five, the ocean, personality traits that, you know, are supposed to not change generally over time. And I did that in about 100 people going through our diabetes prevention program and didn't find any differences or nothing came out surprisingly. So we dropped that measure actually just to reduce participant burden. We've also looked at some of Steve Pietrozzolo's like preference and tolerance for high intensity interval exercise, and didn't find anything there either that was, it wasn't correlated with adherence. So we dropped that as well, but not to say that it doesn't, I guess, just in our population. So yeah, not too much. I think there is, it's more of an individual factor in terms of if somebody, ends up choosing to do HIIT more than somebody chooses to do another type of exercise, that's probably gonna be a bit individualistic, which is in my mind, okay. I mean, the best type of exercise is the one that somebody keeps engaging in. I think HIIT has a lot to offer in that regard, because all of those components that we vary and modify bring uniqueness and diversify workouts. And I think people get bored and tired and want to challenge themselves, etc. So I think HIIT is nice for that.
Very good, thank you.
Okay, so I think we have finished this invited session. I would like to thank you very much, Todd and Mary, for your very valuable contribution and your collaboration. Thank you very much. I think that the main take-home message is that HIIT is feasible and people can do it. And I think by reflecting on all these that we have said and all these that we know, that HIIT should not be treated as one entity. There's a vast majority, you know, there's a vast range of protocols and the formats of HIIT that people can do, that you cannot really say we are comparing HIIT with MIGT. I think this comparison is not valid. We should take each format of HIIT individually. And so long as we know the physiological and metabolic and psychological responses to each of these HIIT formats, then we can apply them safely and appropriately to people. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much, and thanks to the audience. Thank you, Todd and Mary. Have a good evening and have a good morning in California.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Take care, guys.